Alright, so, chapter, I got the new collars today. The blue collar is a new one. So, let's see again. Chapter 3, right?
Yeah, we'll finish it today.
Hopefully. Chapter 3.
I'm putting my glasses on.
We do it well. Sit desk first, desk right here or right there. Section 1, you needed to know and learn about the Forex. Alright, excitement is over, right? You needed to learn about the Forex market, which is that section number 1, which is the currency market, the exchange market, okay? And we discussed a little bit about the gold standard, and we said a little bit about Bretton Woods, and now we are on a floating exchange rate. Except for a number of countries, dozen of countries, like the GCC countries, who are on a fixed exchange rate. We're gonna wait for them to finish, all right? So, you are on a fixed exchange rate. You're fixed to the dollar. The exchange rate was 3.66 to the dollar, correct? 3.65 to the dollar. Okay.
We divide it on the 3.85. When we change it or buy something from outside, it is 3.85.
Okay, well, the point is you're at a fixed exchange rate, not a floating exchange rate. But most of the world runs on a floating exchange rate. The euro floats against the dollar and all other currencies. The yen floats against the dollar and all other currencies. Okay, so most major currencies float against the others. Then we said there is an over-the-counter market. There is a spot market. There is a futures market. Then we mentioned, which you're supposed to remember, attributes that, you know, of banks. You know, what are the attributes that banks need to trade in foreign exchange? And some of the factors affecting the spread. Okay, but you don't need to learn the difference between direct and indirect quotation. That's fairly straightforward. And I mentioned about currency futures, currency options, currency forwards. And that was the currency part. From slide 20, you get the number 2. International money market. That's number 20, okay? And there is in general the European money market, the Asian money market. Sometimes before they called it the Asian dollar market. For a long time, for many, many, many decades, especially since after World War II, the dollar has been the dominant global currency. It is used in trade, in financing. So many Asian countries and companies finance themselves with dollars and they use the Asian dollar market. A lot of European companies, they need dollars, so they finance themselves in European markets. We call these euro-dollar markets. And the main center of the euro-dollar market is London. London has relatively free markets, and they're relatively unregulated, so it's a lot easier to borrow money there and to lend money there. The next thing is that global, because markets are integrated. This is on slide 24, because all borrowing in the world is integrated. Interest rates become similar across different countries and they flow similarly. So when interest rates rise, they get to rise globally. When interest rates fall, they get to fall globally. What does it mean to you? Well, it means that US interest rates are rising as they have been for the last year. This means that your interest rates here would also be rising too. Now, you need to understand the following. Even though, let's say, some Islamic banks don't use interest, interest is part of what is called cost of capital. Cost of capital is the cost which businesses as well as banks finance themselves. And there is cost of capital in the form of debt and cost of capital in the form of equity. When interest rates rise in Europe, cost of capital here will surely rise. Whether it is in Islamic or the modern commercial form, the cost of capital will, one way or another, rise, okay? If cost of capital here does not rise and global interest rates rise, people will move capital out of here. Capital will flow out to where interest rates are higher. So if US interest rates are very attractive and here interest rates are extremely low, they'll simply move out of here to better places. In other words, here, cost of capital, whether it's in the interest form or any other form, again, cost of capital, debt or equity, is the return to investors. So, this is extremely important to understand. Cost of capital is exactly the same thing as return to investors. The cost of capital is what businesses pay to investors. Return to investors is what investors receive from businesses. Okay? So, if you pay me 8%, to me, it is return of 8%, okay? To you, it is cost of 8%. So it is always exactly the same. Now, I never said it has to be interest. It could be a dividend.
Yes, it's more than 8%.
Look, right now I'm saying that you need to understand the concept that return to investor is identical, always, anywhere, everywhere in the world, no matter whether it's conventional.
It's cost of my using my capital.
It is the cost for the one, is the return to the other. It is always Islamic, non-Islamic, no matter what the religion is. If money changes hands, for the one is a cost. For the other, it is return. It is always like that, no matter what the form. That's extremely important to understand. So that's the first concept. The second concept to understand is that if interest rates rise in the United States or in some other countries like China, meaning places that drive the global financial markets, they will eventually rise here. Here it will raise the cost of capital, no matter exactly what the form is, whether the form is Islamic finance or non-Islamic conventional finance, the cost of capital will rise. The reason is competition and capital outflows. If here the return to investors here is lower and somewhere else is higher, capital will flow to the place where it's higher. So this is the point that you need to understand. So this is about the global integration of money markets. Okay, let's see. Next is number 3. Okay, questions here? Questions? No. All right, so this is an important point to understand. Number 3 begins from slide international credit market. That begins from slide 26. Did I cover anything last time? All right, we begin with term loan.
Term loan,
that's slide 26, okay. And this is what would be called medium term. Short term will be typically, let's say, under 1 year. And under 1 year will fall under money markets. So this is going to be like 1 to 3 years or 1 to 5 years. It says loans of 1 year or longer. But in general, I was teaching an hour ago these banking guys, long term is considered if it is 10 years.
Huh? 5 to 10.
Five, well, it's more like 10 years and more. So
25 years.
Hmm?
25 years almost.
No, long term is long term is 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. So 10 years or more. 1 to 5 is considered medium term. And 5 to 10, some people think it's medium term, some people think it's long term. That's not as important. But these are usually 1, 2, 3, 5 year loans. And you also have notes. Notes. And a note is simply a promise to pay. These are called usually Euro credit notes, Euro credit notes, and Euro credit loans. And I think I was explaining to these guys, the banking guys, that usually when the loan is large, very large, too large, one bank can't handle it. It can be too large for a bank. You get what's called a syndicate. And syndicate is simply a group of banks financing the same loan. A group of banks financing the same loan is called a syndicate.
Groups of banks financing?
A group of banks. 3 banks, 5 banks, 10 banks. Usually you're going to get anywhere between 10 and 50 banks financing a large loan, like a $1 billion loan to build a port, to build some major infrastructure.
Financing large.
Large projects, like we call them $1 billion projects, and we call them $1 billion loans. It could be $2 billion, $3 billion, it could be $500 million, but they talk about billions, not millions. A million or two you can just take from the local bank right across the street. Okay, it should be easy, right? Yes, of course. Most people get a couple of million to buy an apartment, just get a mortgage to buy a couple. So millions are not a problem, it's when you get the bill. Now, when you have a syndicate which offers the loan has a name. And it's called a syndicated loan. Syndicated loan. And syndicated loan is a loan made by a syndicate or a syndicate of banks. And the syndicated loan will have one bank that makes all the arrangements with the other banks. And it's called a lead bank. Lead bank. Study. You need to understand that what it's called, there is a Basel Accord is an agreement between a large number of countries, okay, to impose similar or uniform regulations on their banking, commercial.
You can say Basel Agreement, huh?
Yes, it's a Basel Accord. Yes, it's the same as, instead of accord, the word is agreement. The reason was that different countries regulated their banking systems in very different ways, and they needed a regulation to be similar. Basel Accord is agreement between a large number of central banks.
Agreement between large
number of central banks to regulate their banking systems in a similar way.
To regulate
banking system in similar ways. But the original one was that banks must have at least a minimum amount of capital, like a minimum of 4% capital. And then it worked, but didn't work very well, so they had a Basel II. Basel II Accord. I don't remember the year.
But it's minimum amount of capital for each bank.
Yeah, for each bank that banks must maintain.
To be under this agreement.
Yes, to follow the agreement. In other words, most banks, and probably here you're still in Basel II, or you're now moving to Basel III. Basel III is an accord made about 7-8 years ago, I don't remember exactly, and different countries will implement it within 5 to 10 years. So some countries are now moving to Basel III and others are preparing to move.
You're under now, recently under Basel I.
No, Basel 1 is long.
No, Basel 2, right?
Yes, now all countries are pretty much on Basel 2, and Basel 3 was agreed a few years ago, and now many countries are, again, it's easy to agree on the concepts, but it takes 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 years to prepare the banking system. So, some of the first countries are moving to Basel 3, and others are still preparing to move. You just need to know which is your banking system. But again, that's not as relevant. What is important to understand is that this makes banking regulation between different countries relatively similar, so that it controls risks in similar ways. Let's see what else we have. Okay, the next piece here, number 4, is international bond market. So, you got the forex market, international money market, international credit market, and now this is the bond market, international. Where a company will simply issue bonds in a different country. Most of these, if they're in dollars, they're called euro bonds. Euro bonds. It means that it is a, or euro dollar bonds, but they show just called for short euro bonds. Just before we said euro dollar deposits. This is on slide 31. So, these bonds have a number of characteristics. The first characteristic is that they're bearer bonds. It's simply, the bond is just a piece of paper, usually the A4 size. It's just a piece of paper, and whoever has the paper gets the money back. So, if I give the bond to you or you steal it from me, you will get the money back. Okay, so, paper, bearer bond. Whoever bears it, whoever has the bond with him, whoever carries the bond, will get paid. Okay, number one. Number two, annual coupons. Coupon means payment of interest or interest payment. So, these will give you every year one payment of interest. Okay. So that's the second characteristic. And sometimes, I'm not going to discuss this now, they're convertible to stock or callable. Callable means that if the corporation which borrowed the money and issued the bond can pay the bond back earlier than it matures. So if it's a 5-year bond, after 2 or after 3 or after 4 years, if the corporation has the money, can just pay back the bond. So the corporations like this feature that the bond is callable. But investors don't like the callable feature. So in order to induce investors, the callable bond will earn higher interest rate to make it more attractive. So this is the international bond market. You will also have here an important part or feature will be again similar to here, international syndicate. Which is exactly the same syndicate as this syndicate over here. So, a syndicate of investment banks will sell the bonds throughout the world. They may be up in London and probably a London lead bank, but not necessarily. They will be.
They sell internationally bonds.
The bond is international, issued in London under British law. But there will be a German bank like Deutsche Bank. And German Deutsche Bank say, okay, we're going to take, let's say, $100 million, and they'll sell $100 million of that issue in Germany. The Italian bank, let's say Unicredito, will take $100 million and sell it in Italy. Okay, a Japanese bank can take $100 million and sell in Japan. Okay, Spanish bank might sell it in Spain, and of course an American bank might sell it. So you're going to have different investment banks operating in different countries selling a portion of it around the world.
In different bank, different countries, there is a representative or there is a representative or
yes, I mean there may be banks selling them here in Dubai too for Dubai investors or banks if they want to buy it. If they find it attractive, they will buy it. This is what we call market and market competition. They say we offer 4.5% for 5 years. You like it, you buy it. You don't like it, you don't buy.
The bank which is in Dubai, you should buy on it then or not? Only represent to make selling up.
There are two ways. Again, you're asking how is the bond sold? Okay, which means you need to study financial markets and institution. And it can be sold as underwriting. So, example will be the Dubai Bank will buy 50 million and then it will have to sell them or it will have to keep them, but it cannot return it back if it's underwritten. Or
if he buy it with on it, he cancel it with little profit. The representative, the bank is, which is in Germany.
German bank will buy it and it will sell it to German investors in Germany.
With profit, no problem.
Maybe with profit, maybe not a profit. Again, you need to understand somewhere in some other course or some other time what is investment banking and how securities are issued. I can't teach you investment banking here now. Stop my job.
Okay.
If you want, you study it, or if you want, you have chapter 13 or 14 in banking, I can teach you there, but not here. The technicalities and the mechanics, it takes a couple of hours to explain. It's a full chapter just explaining issuing of securities. So the alternative is called best efforts. Best efforts. In best efforts, the bank says, I will try to sell 50 million for whatever I can. And if I can't, I'll return it back to you. So in the first case, the investment bank buys it and guarantees it. In the second case, the investment bank, let's say the Dubai bank, says, okay, we'll try and see what we can do. Whatever we can sell, we will sell. Whatever we can't sell, we'll just return it back to you. Okay? So these are the two methods of selling bonds and in general selling securities. Okay, these are the two main methods. But again, there is long explanation on exactly
yes.
how it works. Maybe there's a full chapter later, but now we just need to understand this part. Alright, so now we need to understand the next part. If you have an international bond, what are the risks? So, it simply means that's slide 34. You ready? So, here the simple question is, which you need to understand to prepare for the midterm is, what are the main risks associated with international bonds?
What are
the main risks associated with international bonds? Interest rate risk. Well, this is the risk that interest rates will rise. And if interest rates rise, okay, for the investor, the price of the bond will fall. Oh, this is interest rate risk.
The price of bond will rise, huh?
No. Interest rates rise, price of bond falls.